Order! Order! You are an incorrigible delinquent at times. Behave yourself, man!
Now, it is a morning of Brexit on the front pages of the papers. There is the Observer. Hard Brexit stance could lose us power, say top Tories. A bunch of Conservative ministers and others there. The Sunday Times has gone with the special one, Mourinho in specially bad trouble with the tax man. But they've also got a very interesting story here about Brexit. We talk about hard and soft Brexit, and I was doing so earlier, and that really offends a lot of people. Apparently now we talk about white Brexit, black Brexit and grey Brexit, if that makes you feel any better. It doesn't make me feel any better, but it might make you feel better. Sunday Telegraph there. Our guest today is Boris Johnson, and there's a plot, apparently, to sabotage his plans for Brexit. That's wicked European diplomats leaking against him. And finally, a hilarious story here on the Mail on Sunday. Panic in number 10 over cabinet Brexit leaks. And how do we know that? Because the panicked memo talking about leaks has itself been leaked in great detail. And we'll talk about that in a moment. But let's start, I think, with you and Anoushka. With that story, in fact.
Yes.
Yes, sorry.
It is.
So there is the memo itself.
It is a sublime leak. This is a very angry letter from the Cabinet Secretary, Jeremy Hayward, saying...
And he really is angry, isn't he?
He really is angry. Because the government wants no running commentary. The problem is that things keep coming out and newspapers are giving a running commentary. And he says, leaking is corrosive and undermines trust in good government. The Prime Minister has directed that we urgently tighten security processes, and anyone found to have leaked sensitive information will be dismissed, even where there is no compromise of national security. So they're really trying to clamp down. And there's another little leak in here I just have to mention. Don't call him Boris. There is another leak.
That's right. It's fascinating, this. We're not allowed to call Boris Johnson Boris because it undermines his authority as Foreign Secretary.
Yeah, that's what they've said to ministers. They need to banish his cabinet clown reputation. Apparently jokes even by the Prime Minister have, you know, undermined him and made his job possible. But funnily enough, the minister and Ian Duncan Smith, the former cabinet minister quoted straight after this, both refer to him as Boris.
Very good. And Theresa May's so-called joke about the Foreign Secretary wasn't that funny. She's compared him to a dog that might need to be put down, which if I was him, I'd feel quite tart about.
Very unhilarious way to treat a colleague, isn't it? But they are obviously in a considerable mess. First of all, they have a huge leak inquiry about the fact that what's being leaked is that they don't know what to do and they haven't actually got a plan. And it all sounds terribly John Major-ish, doesn't it? There's this petulant Cohn's hotline tone about it, of a government that is really so much worried about its own internal affairs and completely out of control of what's really going on.
Peter, as a columnist of forthright black and white views, how do you feel about calling it grey Brexit?
I refuse to use the word, which, as I say, always makes me think of a rather nasty laxative breakfast cereal. But and adding grey to it doesn't make it any better. Here is the introduction of the term in the Sunday Times this morning. A fascinating story about all the various options which are being considered. Allegedly, the government actually believes that it could walk away from negotiations. That's the so-called black Brexit. And then there's a white Brexit, which is everything Theresa May could possibly want: free movement of capital, no free movement of people. Well, maybe. And then there's grey Brexit, which is David Davis's thing, somewhere in between. Very interesting the way that David Davis is emerging in this as the person who can get away with doing things. And this is the point is made here. He can say that we might pay a contribution to the EU and doesn't get slapped down. Whereas the other supposed Brexit ministers are being slapped down all the time. And indeed, there's a story in here that Liam Fox was at one stage allegedly locked in the lavatory. Not the lavatory, I do apologise, locked in his bedroom to prevent him speaking out during a trip to India. He denies it, I have to say, ferociously.
But this is an extraordinary moment when we've got, again, this infuriating phrase, no running commentary. The Prime Minister has said, Andrew, there will be no running commentary again and again and again. But now these people seem to be licensed and they seem to be moving towards a more complicated and a slightly softer form of Brexit, perhaps, than we expected.
Well, David Davis is a much more cunning and experienced politician than most of these people involved. You have to remember, he was a Maastricht whip in prehistory and was also a very effective committee chairman. He understands the ins and outs of politics, and I would imagine that Theresa May has realised she can probably rely on him to get some sort of respectable deal more than any of the others involved.
Very interesting. Now, we mentioned the Italian referendum, Christina Lam, And that is going to be the big story again by this evening. Renzi, the Prime Minister, who's been called the kind of Italian Blair, is in deep, deep trouble, isn't he?
Yes, he is. I mean, following on from Brexit and Trump, this is, you know, aren't we seeing
the
rise of more global populism movements? And Renzi has called this referendum. And I was in Italy a couple of weeks ago and I was watching the adverts for it, and it's the most complicated question. It's a 54-word question. It's all to do with reducing the powers of the Senate. And again, like Cameron, you know, called a referendum that he didn't necessarily need to call.
And these days, the only real question on any referendum paper is, are you really, really hacked off? And if the answer is yes, then the elites lose, and they look like they're going to lose in Italy.
Exactly, and you've got this former comedian, Beppe Grillo, going around mobilising people, and it's yet more sort of anti-establishment feeling. So you have that today in Italy.
Sorry, can I just press you one more time on this? Because the reason this is not entirely funny is the Italian banking system is on the edge of collapsing, and the Italian banks are owned by ordinary Italians. And if that happens, then Italy will be in a real state of maelstrom and revolt.
Absolutely. I mean, if he loses the referendum, he said he will step down, and then there will be a huge amount of instability, and people are extremely worried, as you say, about the Italian banking system. So.
And we've also got Austria as well, coming up, the Austrian presidential election. And Norbert Hofer leads a party which was founded by Nazis.
Exactly, and which not that long ago was praising Hitler's Labour policies. So people are very worried about that. This is a rerun of the elections that were held in June, and he lost then by, I think, about 30,000 votes. So at the moment, the polls are looking very close. But, you know, each time we keep seeing these elections and then the unwanted or unexpected thing happens.
Anushka, I mentioned the Boris Johnson story on the front page of the Sunday Telegraph. Perhaps you could talk a little bit more about that. This is the story we saw developing over the week of Boris Johnson allegedly saying that he was in favour of free movement at private meetings of diplomats. And this appears to be a smear.
Well, that's what he thinks. Let's call him Foreign Secretary Johnson from
now on,
along the lines with the memo. But essentially, four ambassadors speaking anonymously suggested that he had made an argument in favour of free movement. He reacted very angrily to that. And what the Sunday Telegraph has here is a couple of people who were present there essentially saying, no, 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 he didn't say anything controversial, he made his normal argument. Now, that argument, he says and has said since, is to say he's in favour of immigration, but he does believe there needs to be controls. And I suppose the argument is that in line with him saying he's personally in favour of free movement, which is what the ambassadors have said?
Yes, free movement means no control, so that is different, I guess. And we'll be talking to him about that, I'm sure, very shortly. But also about Syria, Christina, you've got another story, because that's the other awful thing going on in front of our TV screens.
Well, I thought it would be only fair if I mentioned Christina's story, because it's probably she's too modest to mention herself, describing the misery of Aleppo, which is considerable in eastern Aleppo. But to me, the extraordinary thing about this is the attitude we have towards it, is that we still take a something must be done view of Aleppo, when in fact what's happening is that the very, very nasty al-Nusra Front, the kind of people who a few years ago we were denouncing as al-Qaeda and regarding as hopelessly impossible Islamists, are being defeated. And that city is finally going to come to the point where there will at least be peace. The only mercy in war is a swift victory, and there hasn't been a swift victory. But after nearly seven years of war in Syria, it looks as if we might be reaching the point where Saudi Arabia and us and the French and the Americans are going to give up trying to overthrow a government, and people can at last begin to rebuild the country.
And do you think there is a realpolitik case for saying that it's been a hideous war, the Russians and Assad have behaved hideously, but actually it's better for this thing to finish?
They haven't behaved any more hideously than we or our allies have behaved in Fallujah or now in Mosul.
Oh, come on, they have behaved. I mean, you've got people trapped in eastern Aleppo as we sit here, 300,000 people there that are being bombed every day. They've bombed the hospitals. Now They've bombed the schools.
Well, our sources for this are people inside Eastern Aleppo. There hasn't, as far as I know, been a single independent Western journalist in Eastern Aleppo. We rely entirely on propaganda sources, on pictures which always show wounded children being carried by noble unarmed men in heaps of rubble. And we rely on this and we take it as read. You never see any of this kind of reporting from Mosul or from Fallujah, where similar things have happened, which have been done by our side. Yeah. And this blackening of the Russians just seems to me to be particularly ridiculous. Well, the thing is nearly over. We should be pleased at least that they can start rebuilding.
I was in Syria a few weeks ago and I saw Assad, and he's very confident because he has created a situation where it is looking like a choice between him and
Islamist
rebels. If
I had Putin at my shoulder, I'd be very confident too.
We're
going to talk a lot more about this with Boris Johnson later on. So can I move back to some domestic politics? And I think you had the story about Paul Nuttall's CV.
Oh, yeah, this is a very funny story. So Paul Nuttall, the new leader of UKIP, who you have coming on, first of all put on his CV that he was a professional player for Tranmere Rovers, which he wasn't, so he had to remove that. Now he's been caught out saying that he's got a doctorate in history from Liverpool Hope University. Well, actually, there was no Liverpool Hope University at the date when he says that he got a doctorate. So,
and he says it was
like
an over-enthusiastic researcher, Peter Hitchens.
That's always it, isn't it? Over-enthusiastic researchers or press officers have put these things out, which is, of course, no doubt the case.
Finally, Stani, you've got a story about the great women of Fleet Street. But before we come to that, I just want to ask you about the Richmond by-election, because this was an extraordinary by-election, in a sense, for the Labour Party, where they got fewer votes than they have members in the constituency. The worst performance, I think, since 1909 in London for Labour. To what extent do you think this is going to provoke a kind of rethinking, and this talk about a realignment of the progressive, so-called, or the anti-Brexit forces in British politics?
Well, there were a number of people in the Labour Party who were calling for the party not to put up anyone against the Lib Dems in Richmond. They want to form this progressive alliance, but I spoke to some of the MPs who made those calls and they got a really hard time from colleagues in the Labour Party who want nothing
to deal with the Lib Dems.
To some extent you can say there are voters who would say, actually, we don't like the Lib Dems any more than the Conservatives. But what happened in Richmond was that they went back to a tactic they've used before. They massively squeezed the Labour vote and they managed to win, which is a warning both to the Tories, because Tory Remainers were peeled away, but also to Labour, because they're worrying a lot about UKIP, but they've got a very, very large number of voters on the other end of their tail.
Have to look in two directions at once. That is sadly all we've got time for. Thank you all very much indeed.
The left in retreat all over the developed world. François Hollande did something extraordinary for a serving French president. He announced he wouldn't be seeking a second term. Now, that means next year's French election, so crucial to Europe and our future, will be between the hard right François Fillon and the extreme right Marie Le Pen. Meanwhile, Zach Goldsmith's goodbye to an eccentric career in Parliament was less voluntary, trounced by a Brexit-hating Lib Dem, Sarah Olney, whose victory reopens the debate on how total our rupture from the EU should be. He, however, said a loud hello to Taiwan, displeasing China's autocratic President Xi, who's probably more powerful even than Donald Trump will be. Good grief. 2017 is going to be a bumpy year. Allegra, Screeny, now say after me, serenity now.
You wish, Robert. There's loads of Brexit for breakfast this morning. Stories about our renegotiation everywhere. We might pay for access to the EU is in the Sunday Times story, but the headline they go with is that we're not calling Brexit hard anymore, we're not calling it soft, instead it's going to be grey, some kind of compromise. Theresa May's style of Brexit has had a very good week. Boris Johnson's, our guest later, not so good. In fact, Boris has had a horrid time. This week it was suggested he told ambassadors that really he loved immigration from the EU. Today, The Telegraph, where is it? It's up here. It comes to his rescue. Indeed, very unusually, it features a quote from the Italian ambassador who was there at this lunch and said he never actually said those words. Now, today, two big events happening across Europe. In Austria, a rerun of the presidential election that might give the EU its first far-right leader. And then over in Italy, they are having a referendum. We've even got a front page for you to prove it. They're having a referendum that could end President Renzi and trigger a referendum on the euro, maybe in their own way as big as Brexit. Now, it is at this point that political journalists like me point to the latest Italian polling, and I will. Let me quickly show you. You can see that no, so curtains for Renzi, is quite comfortably in the lead. Except what's unusual about this poll is that it is 2 weeks old. The Italians have a polling blackout before elections. I'm not one of those journalists who think polls are past it, so I'm still a fan, but the Italian blackout probably means pollsters over there in Italy are the only ones ending 2016 without egg on their face. Robert.
So, in a moment, we're going to have BT's chairman, Mike Rake, and the Foreign Secretary, Boris Johnson, but I'm delighted to be joined by Saeed Avarsi and Ed Balls. Getting the crumbs not everywhere, actually. Why aren't you tucking it? It's very, very disappointing.
Weeks before Christmas.
On a diet.
Oh, dear.
Maintaining
now, look, there was a mini earthquake in South London at the end of the week with the Richmond Park by-election victory for the Lib Dems. Saeed, if I could just ask you, how much do you think this was a Remain territory saying they don't like the sound of a hard Brexit, and how much of it do you think was Londoners actually punishing Zach Goldsmith for a campaign when he ran for London Mayor that many people saw as abusive, borderline racist, something he never apologised for?
Well, if you look at the statistics in Richmond over the years since the constituency was created back in the late 90s. Yep. The Conservatives have, you know, Zach won it and Zach lost it.
Yep.
The Conservatives neither won it nor lost that particular seat. And I think when people voted for Zach, when they first elected him, I think so. I mean, it was a seat that's never been held by us. And I think when Zach did win it, it was all about this kind of fresh-faced, you know, eco, environmentalist, you know, principled politician. And I think there were two factors that played out in his loss.
What was the nasty campaign for the London mayor a factor?
I think there were two things that played out. One, you know, this was a constituency that overwhelmingly voted to remain, and he was very clearly Brexit, and I think clearly that was a judgment that was made, and the Lib Dems particularly ran that campaign. And I think people were also left, sadly, and, you know, I consider Zach to be a great friend. I have a huge amount of time for him, but as I told him during the mayoral election, this is not the Zach that I knew. And maybe this time out will allow him to reflect, really, because, look, we can't carry on running.
Because he's never apologised for a campaign that, I mean, you criticised as being...
It was a terrible campaign.
It was a terrible campaign, but it wasn't Zach, and this is what I think concerns me.
But it doesn't capture British values, did it, of tolerance?
No, it didn't. And one of the things that we have to learn as politicians is that if we run divisive campaigns, we leave a more divided country. So it's not a game anymore. And we've seen that. You know, when we run campaigns with nasty, toxic messages, people on the streets, sadly, then get hurt. And we have to take responsibility for that.
Ed, and we'll talk about this in more detail later, I'm sure, but Labour lost its deposit in Richmond. Bad for Labour, that result.
Well, Labour was irrelevant in that by-election. That's not a good thing, but it's the reality. I think the bigger thing which was happening, other than Zach, was that Conservatives who voted Remain decided it was more important to back Liberal Democrats to send a message. And what it tells you, I think both parties are now divided because you have an urban view about Remain, and then you have a suburban, shire, small town, large parts of the country who voted to leave. There's obviously elements in both parties, but you have a Conservative leadership, which is really of, these days, soft to hard Brexit, the shires outside of the cities, who is alienating voters in Richmond. And you have a Labour leadership, which looks very much of urban, diverse London, which actually is not really speaking to Labour voters who voted to remain all across the rest of the country. The question is, which leader, Theresa May or Jeremy Corbyn, can actually unite the country?
This issue of a divided country seems to me to be the absolute crucial one at the moment.
Right, lots to go over then this week in politics, even perhaps just that interview. I'm joined now by Christian May, editor of the business newspaper City 3am, Sonia Soda, chief leader writer with The Observer, and by the comedian Mark Dolan. Very good morning to you all. I'd say plenty there, even in that alone. Well, there we heard it explicitly, didn't we, Mark? There, Nick Clegg saying he'll work with Tony, as I said, some kind of noughties tribute band put back together. Tony,
well,
and Nick.
I know. I mean, obviously, you could sort of solicit suggestions of names. I'm thinking Wrong Direction. But, of course, that's just a matter of opinion. I mean, I think it's really interesting because there's a clear message from Nick Clegg and the Lib Dems, who are, you know, I mean, Nick Clegg's had a good week. When did you last say that sentence? And there's a message from those victorious Lib Dems, which is, we don't want a hard Brexit. And actually, clear messages on Brexit are absent elsewhere. In a sense, these sort of defunct, unemployed politicians are offering leadership. John Major's piped up and Tony Blair's back in the scene, so is Nick Clegg. Whereas the incumbents seem confused. I mean, you've just interviewed Boris Johnson, who I think, because when he first sort of deliberated about whether he wanted us to leave the EU or not, pre-referendum, we had that few days and was like looking for smoke signals from the chimney. Where's he gonna go? And it seemed like he wanted us to leave. But now he's Foreign Secretary, I'm confused, because this week he said that actually free movement might not be such a bad thing, or at least that's the allegation. You interviewed him. He seemed like he was going to leave the interview halfway through, and then he came back on camera again. So there's a lot of confusion. It reflects a government that are seemingly making up foreign policy on the hoof.
So what do you think, Sonia? I mean, first of all, on the old-timers, not old, but, you know, their political time has come and gone, it seems. Could they reinvent themselves?
I might buy Wrong Direction's best hits, I think. I'd certainly be up for that. Well, I think you saw Nick Clegg there looking very cheerful, probably the most cheerful you've seen him in a very long time. And I think I actually agree with him. He's right that there is this sort of, you know, the idea that the EU referendum was going to sort of put to bed these issues once and for all. Actually, it's opened up a whole new dimension in British politics, you know, out versus in, Brexit versus hard Brexit versus soft Brexit. And that does seem to be the defining political force at the moment. And you've got these two small parties, the Lib Dems and UKIP. We saw the Lib Dems defy expectations last week in Richmond. This week you've got the Sleaford by-election coming up. Now, UKIP haven't got hope in winning it, but what everyone will be looking for will be whether UKIP can, you know, leapfrog Labour into second place. So you've got these two smaller parties with very clear stances, and then you've got Labour, which is in a total mess over Brexit and what its position is, and really struggling to keep together the sort of coalition of voters, some of whom feel very passionately about staying in the EU, some who feel equally passionately leaving. And then the government is in a complete mess, as Mark's just said. We've had all sorts of briefing. I mean, David Davis saying, you know, we would pay in to stay into the single market.
Or did he? I mean, this is the thing, is, you know, we're told, I mean, just bringing Chris in here, you know, we're told no running commentary. Well, we seem to get a running commentary by leak, innuendo and whisper. We get all kinds of different things. Boris Johnson, is he in favour of free movement of people or not? You know, all this is milling around. Would it be better for the government, let's say, post the decision by the Supreme Court early next year, to say these are actually the broad areas that we are going to ask for?
Obviously, as a journalist, you're frustrated on one level that the government simply isn't prepared to set out its ultimate objectives, but you also have to recognise that as an observer of politics and indeed business negotiations, that that's not a practical thing to do. But, you know, David Davis's comment on the fact that Britain may end up paying something into the EU in order to retain some kind of access isn't actually a shock revelation. There are a number of mechanisms that you could achieve that by. You could pay into an Erasmus student programme, you could pay into Eastern Europe Development Fund. Some people do this.
And just with your CDAM hat on, I mean, it's only a discussion I had with some senior figure from the city, said, well, we could pay the money for passporting. You know, we seem to get fined a few billion every year by the government. The government would have to pay, we'd pay for those passporting rights.
Yeah, I think that's right. When we're talking about putting some kind of financial contribution on the table in order to retain some kind of access to the single market, then obviously some kind of negotiation that results in one party paying to achieve access is perfectly acceptable part of it. But there is, of course, the frustration that we don't know the full details. And I think that's something that people are going to have to recognise, that the government's position is a holding position, which is we're not going to give a running commentary. And neither, by the way, is the European Union.
I do think there's a problem with all of this, though. So, you know, all the commentary at the moment is about what Britain would like, and the government doesn't seem to be paying any attention to the fact some of the stuff might not be on offer. The pick-and-choose model where you're like, oh, I'll have a bit of that.
What do you mean, might not be? We've been told explicitly it's not.
Well, yeah,
but that is how negotiation works, isn't it? You have to have a position A, which is your preferred set of options, and you have to have a position C, D or E that you're prepared to fall back on, which might be, by the way, a so-called hard Brexit, WTO trading rules and tariffs. The government should, if you want to put some clarity on the situation, the government should also make it clear, yes, we're after this, but by the way, we can deal with this. This end of the spectrum is OK.
But that's the point, Mark. I mean, on this issue, Mark, I mean, you know, this is the elephant in our room, in the rooms of the other 27. You know, it goes down to mouse size in certain countries because they've got, you know, Austria, the far right, Italy, France,
and
Germany.
Well, of course. I mean, and we saw it again this week with the surprise by-election result. Democracy rears its ugly head. And events may be very defining in this whole Brexit debate, because if there are strong right-wing Eurosceptic forces sweeping through the continent, that weakens Brussels' hand, I'd suggest.
Or indeed left-wing Eurosceptic forces, which includes the Liberal Democrats, so it doesn't include the Liberal Democrats, but it certainly includes the forces at play in the Italian referendum and the five-star movement.
One thing I think might be missing, Dermot, though, is actual political leadership in this country, because I think what you have in Theresa May is probably a very able administrative type of figure who spent a long time in the Home Office getting on with the job. In fact, getting on with the job is one of her catchphrases. I think on this occasion, she's going to have to go a bit more showbiz and a bit more presentational, because what's happening is that an absence of any noise from number 10 about where we're going is producing a vacuum. And into that vacuum, any comment from any cabinet minister is being seized upon, affecting the markets. Mm. So she's going to have to make more speeches where she says nothing, which is what some previous prime ministers have been very good at doing.
Week's other big news, developing from yesterday onwards, Donald Trump and the Taiwanese president, Sonia. I mean, you know, what's wrong with them talking to the Taiwanese president? It's upset the Chinese, but, you know, they're not a democracy.
Well, because it does change, you know, 40, 50 years of American foreign policy. And it seems that President-elect Trump, you know, just thinks that these things can be sort of changed at a drop of a hat. He sort of sent quite an aggressive tweet afterwards, which is his style at the moment in terms of letting the world know what he thinks, where he said, you know, hey, what's the problem with this? He called me to congratulate me. But it's quite an extraordinary state of affairs that this is the way that sort of we're getting hints about foreign policy of the future American administration. And we're actually seeing some, you know, the Taiwanese government has briefed that actually it was a Trump advisor who sort of set up the call. Trump's now said, oh, no, the Taiwanese president called me. I mean, it's really unedifying.
But it's the broad point. I mean, given, Christian, you know, the history of Britain and China, many people saying, you know, we've bent over backwards too many times to curry favour with them. Is Donald Trump, OK, much more powerful nation, but saying, look, I can talk to the Taiwanese president. At least she's elected.
Indeed. It has come to something when voices of the left, or indeed just Trump's broad opponents, are using the fact that he might risk angering a communist dictatorship by taking a phone call from a democracy. If people are going to criticize Trump for that, I accept the broader point about upsetting an apple cart of sort of 40 years of reasonably settled and quite well maintained and staged relations in that part of the world. But this is the sort of thing that Trump might well find that he just wants to do. And it's also the case that if the call did come through to Trump, I mean, this is how most leaders around the world finally got hold of presidents-elect, is that they just called his hotel switchboard and the call gets put through.
I think what happens is, you know when you've had a few drinks and you start texting the wrong people? People you shouldn't be texting. That's basically Trump's...
Is that something you do
that's
often,
his,
Mark?
That's his, last night. That's Trump's foreign policy. It, you know something, the sort of shoot from the hip improv style was great for his campaigning. He said a different thing every day. I think he's going to find in office that every time he says something, we actually take it seriously now. It affects the balance of international relations. And I think he's going to very quickly learn the hard way that this isn't going to work.
Yeah,
take
his phone away. It's not the way to do foreign policy, is it? I mean, you know, you said that you've got people on the left criticising. You know, there is a way, fair enough, if you want to sort of think about changing the course of US foreign policy, that's great. The way to do it isn't like this.
Bear in mind that Trump has made no secret of the fact that if you look at the things he has said about China, admittedly in the terms of trade and economics when it comes into the US, I mean, this is not as if he's suddenly turning course and saying, actually, I've got a thing or two to say about China. He's made no bones about it. He doesn't like them very much. People around him who said that his team knew exactly what they were doing with this.
And of course, he famously doesn't drink. Christian Sonia Marr, thank you all very much indeed. Very good to see you. Well, let's start start straight away by taking a look at the Sunday papers. I'm joined now by Francis O'Grady, General Secretary of the TUC, Douglas Murray, the Associate Editor at The Spectator, and by Chantal-Aimee Dollius, QC, the Chair of the Bar Council. Very good morning to you all. Thank you very much indeed for stepping up to the mark here. Let's start straight away, Douglas, with developments within continental Europe. Perhaps developments, I say, Italy and Austria, crucial votes taking place today.
Yes, one of the most interesting things about the British press at the moment is it's so obsessed with Brexit. But of course, the EU is going on and Europe is going on, the rest of the world is going on. And gosh, how? Today, obviously, the Italians will be going to the polls over the referendum, which their Prime Minister has ordered. It's exceptionally difficult to explain what the referendum is actually about. As the Sunday Times shows, they reported as Renzi resists the march of the radical right. What he's proposing is, of course, that the Italian people can limit the Senate and so on. The actual wording is exceptionally long and exceptionally complex, even by Italian referendum standards. But of course, it's becoming a referendum on Renzi and a referendum on the EU. And an example of the complexity of it, the Sunday Times quotes two people who are supporting the Prime Minister, and one of them says, "I fear we're not going to make it because too many people have been fooled." And one of the other people who supports the Prime Minister says, "Everyone is throwing themselves into it. I'm confident we will just about win."
So where did we hear that before?
You know, it's it really is all to play for, but. You know, it is fascinating. This is going to be a pattern, I would say. Every single vote that happens in Europe is going to end up being about something else.
Yeah, well, I mean, maybe we found that out a little bit with our own Brexit vote as well. There were other things mixed in there. Incredibly complex subject, as we're finding out now. Francis, do you, though, interpret this, and depending which way these votes go, I mean, is it the rise of the far right or is it something different? I mean, it's anti-politics. Does it necessarily have to be the right?
I think there are differences in different countries. Yeah. I think the Five Star movement is different to the Freedom movement, which is certainly a far-right party formed after the war by former Nazis. But I think perhaps the clue is in this article when it talks about 36% unemployment amongst young people. There are real underlying economic causes. Lots of countries have suffered years and years of austerity cuts after the bankers' crash, wages stagnating, people really struggling. And the problem is that too often they turn to easy answers and
well,
migrants
those easy answers.
To blame.
I mean, Chantal-Aimee, what's your take on it in the sense that, you know, we're talking about Italy and Austria now, elections coming up in France, big ones, of course, in France and Germany and in Holland and elsewhere. Do you see a trend, some kind of broad trend?
Well, I think one of the challenges is ensuring that the political establishment is able to appeal to the people sufficiently. And I think while each country is slightly different, actually one of the issues that we've seen across, and indeed probably across to the United States, is a lack of connection between the people or a perceived connection between the people and the establishment politicians, whether from the left or from the right.
And manifesting itself then in specific circumstances in different countries. Francis, well, let's talk about our own country and Brexit. The discussion continue. You're leading with the Observer's lead piece on the front
well,
there.
The front page of the Observer, the Tory party could lose the next general election if Theresa May alienates its core of moderate supporters by becoming UKIP light. And that's not the Observer saying that, that's former Conservative ministers and MPs. And I think, I mean, perhaps we're beginning to see the start of a more pragmatic voice in the Conservative Party saying, instead of talking about hard or soft Brexit, maybe we need to get a deal that actually works for the British people.
Well, we're now hearing it's been termed in Downing Street in colours, not black or white, but a grey Brexit.
Yep, which I think from a TUC point of view, we think a good starting place would be let's put jobs and people's rights at work first. Let's start from that position and build a deal that delivers the best for
But do you believe in the TUC there might be a second referendum?
I can't detect any great public appetite for that currently, but who knows, in the current environment, who knows?
But back to that point the Observer's making, Douglas, I mean, there's this disconnect, and it goes for the Labour Party as well, for many parties, between the constituencies they represent and their views on Brexit. I mean, you know, some Leavers are in Remain constituencies and Remainers in Leave constituencies.
Absolutely. And I mean, obviously, a lot of this is after the defeat of Zach Goldsmith in Richmond by-election. There's obviously a little bit of panicking. I don't think it should be over-egged, this, though. I mean, it's going to be very uncomfortable for some MPs, particularly, of course, Labour MPs who are very, very pro-EU in seats which are, you know, overwhelmingly for Leave. But I think sometimes too much can be read into these by-elections, and this is a sort of, you know, response to something. It's a very specific set of situations, just as the Italian referendum is specific, just as the Austrian election is specific. Right. Richmond by-election was very specific.
But you
specific.
Don't see, I mean, there was that polling, wasn't there, that saying more people define themselves by Remain or Leave than they do by the parties they vote for at general elections. You know, well, fundamental realignment over the years.
Some of us think there ought to be a fundamental alignment, but, you know, I mean, as they say, things that cannot go on usually do. And the political parties have it in their own interests to continue in the way they're currently constructed.
Isn't this also about recognising that in any negotiation there are at least two parties to that negotiation, and it can't just be a case of cake and eat it, as we heard. I was with the Austrian Chancellor on Wednesday in Vienna this week. You know, they have their own set of priorities, their own concerns about what Brexit could or might mean for the political stability and economic security of the EU as a whole. So, you know, I think as a negotiator, you have to put yourself in the shoes of the person on the other side of the table, and maybe people are waking up to that.
And lots of cake there in Vienna as well. That was terrible, wasn't it? Chantal-Aimee, global Britain, I mean, dimension of this in the Times. And this is this about the cultural doors that are opened by Britain's mighty output in music and literature?
Well, that's right. So the article talks about the importance of making a success of Brexit and looking to the global environment, particularly economically. And it's focusing on our soft power. And it talks about Adele and the Bard helping us build a global Britain. I suppose for my members, it's really a focus beyond that. It's looking at making sure that we don't close our doors. And whatever Brexit means at the end of the day, we need to look at the world more broadly. So I've just come back from China, where we were looking to promote UK legal services, which to date are about $25 billion in terms of contribution to the economy. So it's ensuring that we're able to continue to deliver those services.
Well, you have been on your travels. You've been anywhere exotic?
I travel all the time.
But I want to stay with you, Chantal-Aimee, because you talked about legal services, and let's talk about the Supreme Court here. You've got, again in The Observer, a profile of the head of the Supreme Court, David Neuberger.
That's right. So obviously we've got the Article 50 case coming up in the Supreme Court this week, 4 days. This is a very good comprehensive article really telling us about the case itself, which is about whether or not the government or the executive can trigger Article 50 or whether it needs to go to Parliament first. But it goes deeper and it also looks at the president of the Supreme Court and indeed at the judiciary. And for me, it's an important story because obviously a few weeks ago we saw some fairly aggressive headlines pitching the judiciary against the people. And it seems to me that the debate has moved on rightly, recognising
I mean, do you think it will? I mean, depending on which way the Supreme Court rules, and it's already, I mean, in other papers, going through all the 11 members of the Supreme Court and looking, giving them star ratings on whether they're pro or anti-EU, looking at their relatives, looking at what they've said in the past about, you know, human rights and things like that. Do you not think that that is building up again?
Well, I think there's certainly a risk. I think we'll have to wait and see where the press takes it. It seems to me understanding more about our judges, learning more about the justice system can only be a good thing. Quite how far it goes, we'll have to see. The important thing is to remember that whatever the connections of the judiciary, our judges are internationally respected for their ability to be independent.
But would you like to see the politicians, the political class, the senior political class, having stuck up more for the High Court and stick up for the Supreme Court, even if it rules against them?
Yes, I mean, it's important to recognise that the press should be entitled to write these stories, but I think it's essential that our senior politicians stand up for what is, in effect, a cornerstone of our
democracy.
Quick
thought on that, Douglas. I mean, do you think it was mealy-mouthed, the support we heard from Liz Truss, even the Prime Minister, for the High Court judges?
They're in a very difficult position. I mean, it is interesting, this whole discussion of the individual justices on the Supreme Court is becoming very American. I mean, the whole setup of the Supreme Court, some of us felt very American, unnecessary tinkering in some people's views. But, you know, if the judges are going to be involved in politics, then politics is going to take an interest in the judges. And personally, I sort of, you know, regret that it's come to this, but the press is right to take an interest in this. This is about whether or not the Supreme Court stands against the will of the British people. And that is no small thing. It's a huge, huge issue.
Just a quick thought on
my understanding is that this is a judgment about whether Parliament has powers.
Absolutely.
Compared to the government.
And then we'll see whether Parliament stands.
And we'll see whether the British people comes in.
For democracy.
But I'm just picking up on that point.
Judiciary.
It isn't about standing against the will of the people. The Supreme Court are specifically looking at a narrow constitutional point. And indeed, if the judgment is upheld, as Francis said, the decision would then be that it is for Parliament who, at the end of the day, reflects the people.
Okay, and they could go against the people, of course. I mean, that's what this is about.
Well,
this
endless,
that's what the parliamentary system is about.
The huge thing about this is, the British people voted to leave the EU, and a lot of people can't accept that. And there are a lot of ways being invented to stop that.
Well, we're getting back to then. I think the MPs get that. But you mentioned America there, Douglas. I want to stay with you. And Republicans backed Trump after this extraordinary call that he received from the president of Taiwan, going against what goes back to the Carter years, doesn't it, that they don't talk to the Taiwanese.
Yes. This is a really interesting story, I think, because a lot of people who dislike everything about Trump, particularly in the British and European media, will not allow him to put a foot right. And it's very interesting, the criticism that Trump has had for receiving a call from the democratically elected president of Taiwan. In order to attack Trump for that, they are defending the line held by the Communist Party of China. Yeah. Now, I think when somebody does something good, whether you agree with them or not, you should congratulate them for that. But here Mr. Trump is being attacked for speaking to a democratic country's leader.
Thanks for pointing that out. I mean, it makes a lot of sense to me. Chantal-Aimee, staying with Donald Trump, his defence secretary, Mad Dog.
Well, I thought this was an interesting story because one of the differences between the American system and ours is obviously that period of time between the president being elected and actually taking office. And we've got here an interesting article by Neil Ferguson on Trump's latest appointment, which is his secretary of defence. And a sort of fairly detailed article suggesting that although there's been some criticism, one of the interesting things is that he apparently has no illusions about Putin, certainly one of the areas that Trump has been criticised for in the past. So I think an interesting appointment and one to watch out for.
OK, so perhaps not to be afraid, be very afraid. Might be the last story, Francis. See if we can squeeze another one in. You've got, in the Sunday People, an NHS investigation. I haven't seen this one.
This is an important investigation from the People, I think, looking at what's happening in our NHS. Showing that two-thirds of NHS trusts were in deficit last year, that we're not recruiting enough nurses, and that, of course, health service staff are subject to that 1% pay cap, which next year, if inflation goes up, will mean real cuts in pay. So I think it's really asking fundamental questions about how we fund our NHS.
Well, there it is. It's asking. We can see it in the sub-headline there. There is a stark choice, charging or higher tax. Which do you favour?
Well, I think most people would favour collecting the taxes that are due, particularly from the wealthy. But also, I think most people wouldn't agree that, as we saw in the autumn statements, that giving money away to corporations, cutting corporation tax, is the way forward when our NHS is in such dire need.
Let's end on The Great Escape to the Movies. Chantal-Aimee.
This is a short story. I thought it...
The annual Christmas airings.
Well, indeed,
isn't
that,
it?
One has a sense of that.
A bit of a tradition
that.
That's gone, though, now, hasn't it?
So, well, it's a story to do with a German POW who left his fortune, he's just passed away, to a Scottish village who looked after him while he was a prisoner of war in Scotland after the war. And it seems to me it's a nice story reminding us of some of the difficult history of Europe, but also looking towards humankind. And he remembers in particular how they smuggled him out for an evening to see a film.
They took along their brother's school uniform.
It makes you wonder whether Scotland has a role in rehabilitating former right-wingers to a fairer and kinder view of society.
Right. Yeah, I suspect that the Scottish view is creating right-wingers as we speak.
Okay, I was just going to end on perhaps the next Austrian president, if it is, he might spend some time there. Thank you all very much indeed.
So, Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson has accepted that Britain might pay something into the EU budget after Brexit, though he says there's no reason why the contribution should be too onerous. That was after the Secretary of State for exiting the EU, David Davis, suggested earlier this week that Britain would indeed consider paying for access to EU markets after Brexit. This is what Mr Johnson said on The Marr Show.
A lot of people will be watching and think, hold on a second, after Brexit, are we going to be paying large amounts of money to the EU in return for access to markets?
I've given you an indication of the kind of payments that I think might be sensible.
So small, not large.
I see no, my own view is I see no reason why those payments should be large. And as I say, I do see a big opportunity for us to take the money that we're getting back and spend it on other priorities.
Toby, the papers this morning are awash with the minutiae of Brexit, spinning whatever they've got, depending on whether they're a Remain paper or a Leave paper. Is it not getting close to ridiculous?
It does feel a bit absurd, and I think it's just, unfortunately, the effect of the government not announcing, not declaring what its Brexit strategy is going to be. Unfortunately, because the government has said it can't do that without showing its hand in the forthcoming negotiations, it's difficult for the government to now row back on that. So I'm afraid we're going to see this kind of febrile speculation for months, if not years, to come.
So we've got The Observer leading with a couple of diehard Remain Tories. They're not happy. Surprise, surprise. We've got The Telegraph, a Leave paper, saying, oh, the Italian ambassador says the ambassador didn't say this about Boris Johnson earlier this week that Sky News ran endlessly last week. But Toby's point is right. This sort of flotsam and jetsam, the government's only got itself to blame.
Absolutely. And you've got this situation where we've now got what, clean Brexit, dirty Brexit, white Brexit, black Brexit, grey Brexit, hard Brexit, soft Brexit. Actually, the big question that all of this speaks to is single market. And that's what really this morning was about. Mm. Norway pays more per capita into the EU budget in order to access this EEA, the European Economic Area. Mm. And that's the question that we really need kind of clarity
on.
It
doesn't actually pay more than we do, but it pays a lot.
More per capita?
No, it doesn't.
I believe it's 79 per capita. Anyway, we'll have this argument
later.
Your
point is well made.
It pays a lot of money to get this access. And Boris Johnson this morning was saying that we don't want to pay, we only want to pay a small amount.
But he didn't seem to be talking about anything but that. But here's the bad news, I would suggest, Tom. This is going to continue until the government fills the vacuum, which means not this year.
No, probably not next year either, because I don't think we should expect anything massively revolutionary from the government when Theresa May does trigger Article 50. And in fact, maybe not even in 2018, because we'll really only know the shape of the deal and what we actually get come March 2019.
But they will have to outline in more detail their strategic goals.
No, I don't think they will at all. I think they can keep flamming along with this sort of line of the best possible trade deal and control of immigration, with maybe a couple more details of we're prepared to consider budget contributions. By the way, on the budget contributions thing, I would suggest the BBC is misreporting Boris Johnson this morning.
Surely,
I didn't hear him at any stage this morning say he's happy with budget contributions. He's merely happy to contribute to sort of small schemes like Erasmus.
Now,
contributing to the budget is a very different thing. That's paying billions, potentially, into a pool of money of which, if you're out of the EU, you have even less control of.
David Davis was talking about a bit more than that, but again, it was unspecified. The problem is that it's a red flag for lots of people who thought there would be a lot more money to spend in this country if we left the EU, the famous figure up on the bus. Well, the more that David Davis and Boris Johnson spend it in other ways, the less there will be.
That's true. But I think Helen's right that it looks as though, insofar as we are beginning to glimpse a government strategy, they are willing to pay to access the single market. It's just a negotiation will partly be about how much. One aspect of all this, which is often overlooked, is that the Article 50 negotiation is separate from a free trade negotiation. They're often run together, and we don't know yet whether the negotiations towards agreeing a free trade agreement can begin at the same time as the Article 50 negotiations, or whether they have to wait until the Article 50 deal has been concluded before then embarking on the free trade negotiation. And if they have to do that, then there'll be speculation about what that free trade agreement will look like for 5, maybe even 10 years.
My understanding is they intend to do them in parallel, but I wouldn't take my understanding to the bank.
It's not Michel Barnier's suggestion, the Commission's chief negotiator.
He wants one. Oh, no, I understand. That's why I caveated it. Otherwise, you'd be criticising us again. I've been getting
away with it all.